Quantitative Oxford, and with the Mann Institute, is that right? I'll hand you over to her.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. So, as part of the mission of the Alan Turing Institute, it was said that its goal is to make great leaps in data science research in order to change the world for the better. I'm extremely excited to be part of the Alan Turing Institute, partially because my own vision for my own research and my own hope for my own research is to achieve this goal. So I hope to be able to work with collaborators and students to work towards this goal. So the work in the past decade that I have done together with my group has been on machine learning, data science, and decision making for a better planet. The applications that I'm currently the most excited about are in medicine, in education, and finance, and I'm going to briefly tell you a little bit about my research in this area. But I've done work in the past on smart cities, transportation, social media, and energy. I'm also doing research in my group on game theory and applications and on social, economic, and biological networks. But in view of time today, I will not talk about those. Perhaps the first thing that comes to your mind when thinking about data science nowadays is big data. But in my opinion, an equally important aspect of data science is intelligent use of the available data, at times small, to understand and act in complex environments. As we are making predictions, and as we are learning, we are making decisions. And as we are making decisions, we are affecting future data. So decision-making and learning are intertwined. And at times, this makes the problem more complicated, especially when we are acting in complex environments, such as finance or medicine. I'm an engineer, so in the end, I care about algorithms and methods working in practice. But I also care about proving theorems. And I think that this is very important. The reason is we would like to come up with algorithms and methods, but also be able to say under what conditions and circumstances these methods and algorithms are going to be optimal, and for maybe what data these algorithms are going to be optimal. We also would like to understand how many samples we will need to be able to say something about how confident we are in the decisions and predictions that we are making. Also, we would like to say something about the speed of learning of our methods. So theorems are equally important in my opinion. We have developed in our group a variety of methods in learning and decision-making from time series data, graphical models, counterfactual estimation, reinforcement learning, multi-armed bandits, and multi-agent learning and decision-making in both cooperative and competitive environments. In view of time today, I'm going to just mainly tell you about some of our work, and I would love to tell you more about some of our other work and hopefully collaborate with you along these methods as well as the methods that you are developing. An area that I'm probably the most excited right now is machine learning for medicine. And the idea here is that we would like to extract actionable intelligence from electronic health record data and use this data to provide actionable intelligence in the form of predictions, recommendations, as well as clinical practice guidelines. So we'd like to help doctors by learning from this data to make better decisions. We don't want to replace the doctors, but rather work with the doctors to provide them with methods and tools to be able to learn from the data. This will be enable us to have cycles of continuous improvement. A first question that may come to your mind may be, how does this relate to what we are doing now, which is largely based on clinical trials? A disadvantage of clinical trials is that it takes a long time to prepare. They are very costly. And at times, even doctors wonder whether the patients that are enrolled in such clinical trials are really representative. For instance, elderly, which are very often the ones suffering from many diseases, are often not enrolled in clinical trials. And if they are patients that are enrolled, usually tend not to have multiple comorbidities. So we are not really learning about representative patients. So this type of approach of machine learning from electronic health record data can overcome a lot of these disadvantages, but it also has challenges because the data is logged in the electronic health record with bias. Bias of the doctors making decisions based on their own expertise and their own beliefs. clinical practice guidelines which may be pushing the data collection in a certain direction. So we will need to learn while considering these biases. So the focus is in our group to try to build methods to help doctors make better decisions, mainly in the hospital, for diagnosis and prognosis, screening and testing, and treatment and interventions. There are three main components of our work. First is knowledge extraction and representation, where we are using this observational data, build physiological models, and I'm going to show you an example of it, to subtyping and causal inference and extract knowledge, which can then we can use for healthcare policy design. For instance, optimal screening policies that are personalized to the patient or optimal treatment plans. And finally, this knowledge can be used for medical discovery. What do I mean by medical discovery? Very often, one may believe that a disease has, for example, two stages. But we may learn from data that the disease may, in fact, have four stages. And the transients between these states are important in treating and understanding this disease. It may also be that we are discovering from data that two diseases that were believed to be very different are, in effect, quite similar. And the way to manage them are quite similar. So this is important also for discovery. The work that we have done together with our colleagues at UCLA in the medical school, mainly in these four areas, in cancer, personalized screening, and diagnosis. In the area of breast cancer, currently in many countries, there is the following approach. Either women are that have very high risk for breast cancer, either due to family history or other factors, are screened much more often, but then women, the remaining of the women are screened equally. Yet, it is clear need for stratification of the risks of the various women. Most women may not be at this very high risk, that maybe they have a gene expressed in a certain way, but rather they are still at quite high risk because of other factors. How to stratify these different patients and how to understand how often we should treat, we should scan women, and possibly with what imaging modality. Shall we do a mammogram? Shall we do a mammogram followed for MRI? What type of information we should acquire and how often, while being mindful of the cost associated with it. In personalized treatments, we have developed some methods that are again for the area of breast cancer. We have looked at what type of chemotherapy regimens are going to be working most effectively and for which women. Some other work was on organ transplants, where we are trying to have personalized matches for organ donors and recipients, cardiovascular diseases, where we are building personalized risk models which can inform a diagnosis. And what I'm going to tell you about today is timely prognosis and intervention management. And if you are interested in understanding and reading more about this research and possibly collaborating with us, here is our website, which summarizes some of our work in this area. However, I'm going to tell you today about some of the work that I'm most excited about, both because we have done extensive work in this area and currently our system is under implementation at the Ronald Reagan UCLA Medical Center, but also because it has the potential to save many lives. Currently in the US every year, around 200,000 patients that are hospitalized experience cardiac arrest. And 75% of those patients actually die. Yet it is believed that 50% of those patients could have been saved. So this means 70,000 unnecessary deaths that happen in the hospital. So what can we do? We can try to build methods that are helping doctors understand who will need, who is clinically deteriorating, may need medication, or may need to be admitted to the intensive care unit, and when. What is the problem with this? Well, ICU is a scarce resource, so you don't want to send everybody to the ICU. Hence, you need to identify which patients need to go to the ICU and when. And time is life and minutes matter. And the system which we have developed together with the clinicians at UCLA, which we call Forecast ICU, is really able to save lives. So I'm very excited about that. Let me tell you a little bit about the data science and machine learning aspects of it. So we have physiological time series data is this one, which represents the diastolic blood pressure of a patient just hospitalized for quite a large number of times, for a large number of hours. And you can see here his diastolic blood pressure. And if I zoom in, you are seeing that the samples are collected at kind of different rates. There may be noisy measurements also. Also, what you can see is at some moment in time, the patient was admitted to the ICU. And I'd like to draw to your attention the fact that the diastolic blood pressure of this patient was around 40. The person was almost dying when he was admitted. And in reality, if we would have detected that this clinical deterioration happens earlier, we may have been able to intervene and maybe not even admit the person to the ICU, or at least admit it earlier, before he's in the brink of dying. So what can we use as information to make such predictions? We have this type of time series data, which is collected with different frequencies. For different people and for different diseases, may be collected with different frequencies. Also, we have lab tests, which are collected with yet another frequency, and also admission information. We use this wealth of information to be able to predict clinical deterioration in the hospital. So we have an observable process like the one presented here, which is often a continuous time stochastic process, which is sampled with a certain frequency. But what we are interested in is not to predict this type of stochastic process, but rather understand and predict the underlying unobservable true states of the patient. We want to know whether the person is really quite stable and is able to go home, or is clinically deteriorating and needs to be rushed to the ICU. So it is the unobservable true states that we are trying to learn. So what are the limitations of standard approaches? Well, a Markov model is not adequate because the true states are not observed. And if you look at the state of the art literature in this area, most of it is using a hidden Markov model, but that is also not adequate. The reason is the transition probabilities depend in this type of work on the sojourn time. What do I mean by that? As a patient is experiencing, for example, atriatic fibrillation for a large number of hours, the probability of him moving to a bed state where cardiac arrest may happen or mortality is much higher than moving to a state where the patient can be discharged. Also, as a patient is staying, for example, after a surgery and is feeling very good, then the probability of moving to a good state is also much higher than the patient may be discharged. So this needs to be modeled adequately. Also, we have irregularly sampled data. We have partially observed processes, and I'm going to talk about that because modeling correctly the data gathering process can improve our inference methods. And we have conditionally dependent observations. So depending on the state, we may see correlated observations. In addition, we have informative censoring. We know when the person, for instance, was discharged. And this is informative. We know when a person was admitted to the ICU. This is informative and needs to be considered. So for this, we have built a new model, which I'm going to call a hidden absorbing semi-Markov model, which is a versatile model that generalizes previous models in this area. It models the continuous time data gathering process. I'll talk a little bit more about that. And it captures heterogeneity, different number of states for different types of diseases, different types of state transitions for different types of patients. All of that can be learned on the basis of this model. This is useful for medical applications such as ICU prognosis, where we are currently using this model, but also to model disease progression. It also can be used for other applications, for example, in finance. Let us look at this model in a little bit more detail. You see here the different states and the state transitions between them. Note also that we do not have state transitions. The only self-transitions, we don't have self-transitions. The only place where we have self-transitions is in the two absorbing states, which for the sake of this model are the safe state where the patient is going home and the catastrophic state where the patient either dies or experiences some very adverse event, or for instance, goes to the ICU. As you can see again, the time in which we are staying in a particular state is different, differs per state. And what we are in effect computing is what is, given the fact that now the patient, believe the patient is in state two, what is the probability that he will clinically deteriorate? Okay, so we are able to make forecasts on the basis of this model. Also, we have a stop in time, and as I mentioned, this is informative. Now, these transition probabilities, as I mentioned, do depend on the sojourn time. So we have no self-transitions, but rather an explicitly specified distribution, and such a distribution is state-specific. We model this using a semi-Markov model. The different parameters of our hidden absorbing semi-Markov model are the sojourn time distribution, which we model as a gamma distribution, which is a superset of exponential distribution or Erlang distribution, which are useful for us because we will see that at times in the medical data sets that we have. We have semi-Markov on transition functions, and the observable process that we are observing is a model as a Gaussian process with constant mean and square exponential covariance kernel. Let me now spend a little bit of time on the data gathering process, because that's important. So we have the physiological data, which is gathered over irregularly spaced intervals, and we model this observation via a point process. If this, we could model this, for instance, as a Poisson point process, but in many settings, in the medical setting, we would like to take into consideration that these observation times are in fact informative. When we see more measurements of, for example, the blood pressure, we know something bad may happen to this particular patient. So hence, the sampling times are in fact correlated with the states. So we can model this as a Cox point process. And this will be very useful for us because this is informative now. Even if we don't observe what is the actual value of the blood pressure, just the fact that we observe there are many observations can improve the predictive power or inference algorithm. We are observing this data, and what we are also seeing is that some moment in time censoring, as I mentioned, and the censoring, again, it's used to improve the predictive power of the inference algorithms. And this represents such a hidden absorbing semi-Markov model episode. So both the data gathering process and the censoring are informative. And for that, we needed to build new inference and learning algorithms. I'm not going to talk about them in the detail because I will need much more time, but I would love to tell you more, or please look at our website to see the details of this work. What I want to tell you about is that this system is not just math, it works in practice. We have, for a couple of months at UCLA, have tried the system on a variety of patients, a total of 6,000 patients with very different types of ages, very different types of diseases, very different types of severity of diseases. And this has been a challenging problem. Yet our system worked so well that is now under current deployment at UCLA. I'm going to show to you just one plot. If you want to see many more, they are in our work, and I invite you to look at it. What I'm showing here is just one plot which shows sensitivity versus the PPV, positive predicted value. And what I compare is our system, which is called Forecast ICU, as compared to the existing scores currently used in hospitals. State of the art currently used in a hospital is the Rothman index. And what you can see is that we do orders of magnitude better than that. And Rothman index does by itself quite a lot better than the older existing scores. What I also like to say is not only that we do a lot better, but the number of false alarms that we can achieve is a factor of three less than the Rothman index. And that is very important because one of the reasons the clinicians were not willing to really take into consideration the Rothman score is that it was generating a very huge number of false alarms. So that led to alarm fatigue. The doctors were ignoring it. So reducing the false alarm was a very important property of our work. Another thing is timeliness. So we are able to show that on average, 8 hours earlier, we are able to predict than clinicians that somebody is clinically deteriorating. And this is very important because, as I mentioned, even minutes saves lives. We have also compared with state-of-the-art machine learning techniques, from ensemble learning techniques to neural networks, and our method is significantly better than those, partially because we are modeling correctly both the data gathering process, but also we are using the sensoring, the informative sensoring. And again, you can find more details about our work here. Our model is actually a generalization of many other models. It's a very versatile model because it can capture the features of many existing methods, models. And this is very useful because depending on how we are trying to model a particular type of disease or a particular type of condition, having access to a variety of features is very useful. But this complicates also our life. In the process, we needed to come up with new methods and new algorithms for both inference and learning. Now, let me switch gear and tell you about another area that I'm very excited about, and that's personalized education. The current trend in education is that larger and larger classrooms we are experiencing, both in conventional education, but also in MOOCs. And this trend does have negative effects on students. We are treating the students as one size fits all. And this leads to poor learning, retention, and engagement. And really, the trouble is students are heterogeneous. They may have different abilities, different backgrounds, different goals, different interests, different ways in which they are learning. So ideally, what we would like to do is we would like to build a way in which tutors or mentors could be provided to every student. So we like to operate as if we will have one mentor for one student. We cannot do that in practice. But what we can do is use machine learning and data science techniques to electronically create such a mentor. So we built an electronic personalized interactive environment that learns over time from how the student learns and based on the feedback of the student and is personalized to the student. We call this IP. We are not so good as Argo with acronyms. I will need your consultancy. So we have different types of modules. I'm not going to go through them. Again, we created a website. You can look at it. I'd love to collaborate with you if you are interested in this topic. What I'm going to do is just zoom in one particular algorithm that we have developed, which is a personalized tutor, which learns over time on what type of examples a student would like to see or would benefit from seeing to learn a particular concept. I used to be teaching digital signal processing at UCLA, and actually this system I used in my class, different types of students are having actually learned maybe from graphical examples of seeing the convolution. Some other would like to see a particular example, maybe with a signal such as music to understand what is happening. So finding different types of examples, trying to personalize these examples and learning from the feedback and the learning process of the students is what we are trying to achieve here. What is interesting that as part of doing that, we again needed to build new mathematical models and new machine learning methods. We built in on the area of contextual multi-armed bandits, and we built some new strand of bandits, which I'm calling staged bandits, which are learning in stages based on feedback that's obtained from homeworks, from tutors, from final exams. In yet another application, we are trying in finance to predict fraud and default. The problem is challenging, for instance, in the case of credit card fraud, because we have many features for the customers. We have many features for the retail chain at which a particular customer may make a particular purchase. So understanding really how we can deal with this wealth of features to predict credit card fraud is a challenging problem. And we have developed an ensemble learning technique that is able to sift through these many features and effectively learn. And this is our method. And as you can see, it's doing quite a lot better than existing ensemble learning methods, which have been shown as being state of the art in this area. In yet another work, we have looked at mortgage defaults. Longer ago, we have collaborated with IBM Research Watson to work on smarter city. This is older work by now. Our focus has been on mainly on transportation, trying to understand how we can alleviate congestion in a city, and also how we can maybe predict and avoid collisions. And what we have developed together with them is a suite of real-time streamlining and decision methods. And I'm actually quite happy that together with them, some of these ideas ended up in products in IBM Infosphere's product. So as I mentioned, for me, data science is very much about interesting applications, but also building new algorithms and methods to support these applications and doing this systematically, at times proving theorems about these algorithms, such that we can really guarantee that they are working. One more time, I'm very excited to be part of ATI. I really hope to work with as many of you as possible, collaborator students. I'm new to UK, so I really hope to build a large network of collaborators, and we hope to make the planet better. Thank you. Yes.
So are you familiar with, there's a chap over in Duke called Dan O'Reilly, who's written a book called About the Truth of Lying, and he's looked at fraud. It's quite interesting. Apparently, a lot of people cheat on their tax returns, a little bit, and then you get these edge case examples where people cheat an awful lot. But the actual sum of, sort of the sum cost is actually there's more, the more people doing small cheating is actually more costly than the big cheats. Related to what you were doing, did you see any of that in your fraud data? Right.
Interesting question. We saw most of the time here was in the data set that we had, the focus was much more on detecting that somebody else may have used your credit card. So the focus was, if somebody is trying to use your credit card, for example, your bank would like to detect that and send you a text message or an email or a phone call to say, have you made it and did this purchase? So it's mainly about timely detection of credit card frauds rather than people really trying to cheat themselves. So this was more a prediction problem. But what you are saying is really quite interesting. I've not read the book that you mentioned about what there is. And it's interesting to me is that it relates to some of my work on game theory, where what you are trying to do is in certain settings, you may want to, you may have a utility function where you are trying to steal as much money as you can possibly without being detected. So it's more an adversarial type setting. And there could be incentives on both sides to kind of both on one hand detect as well as prevent such frauds. But no, we have not looked at that. Any other questions?
I actually think we have to wrap it up because we've run out of time. So I just want to thank all the speakers for coming today. So one more round of applause.